I'm Nance Warren, reporting for WBBOH News. Authorities have said they now understand the connection between the alarming rise in Sasquatch snackage theft and the rising sales of Yeti Bar soaps. Experts now say the Sasquatch are using Yeti Bar soaps to remove their signature scent, enabling them to get terrifyingly close to humans and their snackage without being noticed. Although reports of the scents used by the Sasquatch vary by region, one thing is clear. The Sasquatch have greatly increased their ability to steal human snackage with impunity. Experts advise that one way known to minimize the loss of snackage is for humans to also use Yeti Bar soaps. This will stop the Sasquatch from finding them by their human scent. Authorities are urging everyone listening to protect themselves by going to www.yetibars.net and use the code BB10 to get 10% off their order. Stay tuned to WBBOH News Radio for further breaking developments. Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Hello there, everyone. Thanks for stopping by tonight. Our trip into Sasquatch Valley will have us going all over tonight. First up, we're heading to a state that is known by various names such as the Pine Tree State, the Polar State, and the Border State, just to name a few. That's right. We're going north into the deep woods of Maine. From there, we're going to stop over right here for a spell, right here in the Buckeye State itself. Then, we're going to head on south to one of the more famous states in the United States, Texas. Well, as you can tell, that's a lot of ground to cover, and that's going to require a good load of snackage. So go get your plates piled high with some goodies. And, you know, they can be healthy, by the way. Me, I would suggest some apple slices with some peanut butter on them. It's pretty healthy, and the horses love them. Oh, and I hear Sasquatch is pretty fond of apples, too. So go on, put a few extra in those saddlebags. It's time to mount up and move them out. Let's go. Hello. I have been listening to you for about 6 months now. Back in 2019, I had bought a new truck. Well, new to me. It was a 2014 with low mileage on it. It still had the new smell in it. A few of my neighbors had asked me if I had gotten the chance to visit a place called Tolly Wally in Livermore, Maine. It's about 8 miles down the road from me. I said no, but now I can go check it out now that I have a vehicle that can get in there. A little bit of history of Tolly Wally. Back in the day, it was known to be haunted by ghosts, or that's what the locals wanted people to think. I managed to get one of my neighbors to come with me. He said he would, but he also said that if he heard anything, we were to leave immediately. I said okay, and then I jokingly called him a chicken. He laughed at me. Then he told me that he's heard stories about that place. I said that so had I, and that was why I wanted to go check things out. I said, "Where's your sense of adventure?" He said, "He's just not into ghosts." We get out onto the trail, and about 3 miles in, it opens up to a clearing next to the Androscoggin River. The trees had been cut down to make the clearing, and there was a cabin there. I said, "Let's go check out that cabin." We walked in, and it had a small kitchen to the left, and to the right, a full-size bathroom. Straight ahead was a door that entered into a bedroom-slash-living-room combo. There were some kids' toys there, and there was litter all over on the floor. Just from looking at the condition of the place, it looked like someone had been squatting there, and they left in a hurry. My neighbor got scared and said he wanted to leave, now. I said, "We haven't even heard anything yet. Nothing's happened." But I turned around, and my neighbor was already in the truck, waiting for me to get in. I closed up the cabin and got into my truck. I looked at him and I said, "Yeah, just when my adventure's getting exciting, you want to leave." He said, "I have had enough. Let's go." So I started up the truck and we headed back home. My neighbor asked me if I felt any ghosts while there, and I said no. the land isn't haunted, which leaves the question of what is there? I was disappointed that I had to take him back home. When I dropped him off, he looked at me and asked, "Where are you going?" I said, "I'm going back there. I was having fun." He looked at me and he said, "I was crazy." But I left him and I went back. I had at least 4 more hours of sunlight. This time, I went in about 5 miles until I came to a field where I could turn the truck around. It was a clear, sunny day, and there was a light breeze in the air. I could hear something in the woods moving around. I didn't pay much attention to the noise. I then decided to head back. I had both windows down, and my truck was moving very slow. I was enjoying my ride. When I was almost to the end, I noticed a road to the right of me that was grown in a bit, so I drove my truck up the hill and turned the truck around so that if I needed to get out in a hurry, I could. I got out of the truck, and I noticed that I was standing on top of some kind of bunker. I started to look around me, and then I noticed cameras were in the trees. It looked like they had satellite internet. All of a sudden, I heard noises, like a baby crying. I thought, "That's weird." I looked around, and I saw speakers also up in the trees. That was what was playing the crying noise. I thought to myself, "Who would be doing this, and why?" So I yelled out loud, "You don't scare me." I was looking for the opening to the bunker, but I couldn't find it. Then I heard another noise in the woods. It sounded like a girl was being mauled or attacked. I started walking in the direction of that noise. At that point, I did not feel threatened, just more concerned. But when I reached the trail, my gut feeling was screaming at me to turn around, and the hair on the back of my neck was standing up. I turned around, went back to the truck, and got in. I started the truck up, and I was driving slowly down the hill. I started to hear whistling, like some kids were whistling at me. I didn't think much of it at the time. Then the rocks came. I did not like that. All I could think about was my truck getting all their marks on it. So I left, and I went back home. As I came out of the woods, the neighbors that lived near that place were looking at me strange when I went by them, like they knew something that I didn't. By this point, I was mad, so I blow by my house, and I noticed my neighbor was out on his porch with some of his friends. I went to the store to get me something to drink and to calm my nerves down. The store clerk asked me if I was okay, and I said yes. Why? She said, "Well, I knew you were down at Tollywally." What a small town, I thought. My face must have been red by this point, and I was getting madder by the minute. My neighbor had told everyone that I was down there by myself. She asked me if I saw anything while there. I said no, but I heard some strange noises, and some young punks were throwing rocks at my truck. Everyone in the store got quiet. One of the men in the store said to me that I was pretty brave to go down there by myself. I said, "I was raised by hunters, so that doesn't faze me one bit." Then he told me some information that I didn't know about Tollywally, that the land was recently bought up by the government. So, what did the government want to do on that land? I wasn't thinking clearly at the time, and I was heading out the door. The man then asked me one more question. He asked if they had gotten my scent. I said, "That's an odd question to ask," and I walked out of the store. Now I need to go pick a fight with my neighbors for telling everyone in town where I was. I get to his house, and his friends had already left. I walked into his house, and I asked him what his problem was. Why was he telling everyone where I was? He looked at me with concern on his face. He said that while I was looking at everything in the cabin, he heard something in the woods, and he saw movement that spooked him. He went on to say that I need to start paying attention to my surroundings more. And you know, he is right. I should pay more attention. I said to him, "What are you people not telling me?" I said, "I did what you asked. There is no ghost there. It is not haunted land. So what is the big deal?" He said that he got worried and called his friends over. They were going to come looking for me. I laughed at him when he said that, and I said, "Oh, now you're going to be brave, huh?" I went home after that. About 8 months after all that happened, weird things started to happen around my house, like banging on the side of the house. I found rocks on my porch roof, and the wildlife were acting weird. The neighborhood dogs would bark and whimper like they were scared. This went on until 2020. I thought it was teenagers doing this to me just to be funny, so I went out and I bought big floodlights and motion sensors to light up the whole neighborhood, and it stopped for a while. Then in the fall of 2020, the whole neighborhood got awakened at 10:30 at night with strange noises coming from the backwoods behind my house. It walked the whole length of the hill ridge, screaming. It was a noise I had never heard before. Everyone turned on their porch lights to come out and see what was going on. I went out on my porch to see if I could see movement, but nothing was there. My neighbors asked me, "What kind of animal was doing that?" I said, "I didn't know. But what I do know now is that I believe we have a Bigfoot living here, and the people who have been living here their whole lives know this to be true. It's all making sense to me now. So many rules to follow. One of them was that all of my leftovers were to be put across the street for the animals. I wanted to make a mulch pit, but no, they said it has to go across the street." And a side note, being raised by hunters, you learn about the woods and the animals that live there. Whenever I was in the woods and I saw a bear or a mountain lion, wolves, coyotes, or even a fisher, the birds and the bugs would all still be making their noises. So that leaves the question of what is the real predator? What will make the whole forest go quiet? Well, that would be Bigfoot. Now, this wasn't the only creature that I have ever seen. I have seen plenty more. I have had other encounters with Bigfoot when I was a kid in Minot, Maine, and also somewhere in Canada on my family's land. You see, I know what they look like, but I don't know their characteristics or their habits, not until I started listening to you and the stories from everyone else. Thanks, signed, Kelly. Dear Nance, it's been pretty quiet here over the winter, but I might add, it's been noisy at times. Last August, my fiancé recorded on video some calls. Hard to explain exactly what it was. After the video was recorded, I'd say for the next couple weeks, dare I say it, there was a black helicopter flying overhead here, very low, skimming the treetops. My house is on a hill, and it was low enough that I could see its belly. The numbers were present there, but they were subdued. I did catch the first two letters, but that was all. The big investigator everyone knows was spotted in the area at that time. But I looked on that website, and there are no reports listed for this area. A friend had reported a sighting here years ago, and his report is not there either. I'm not sure why or what is going on around here. We are not the only ones with sightings or noises or wood knocks, which in the last two nights, we can hear one knock, a pause, knock, pause, knock. Last night, it was like this until a ways off we could hear a knock reply. So let me reiterate a bit. I have Sasquatch stickers on my truck, statues in my yard, and a lot of Sasquatch t-shirts that I wear. I was getting gas in my truck one day, and this biker asked me if I believed. And I said, honest answer? Absolutely, I believe. After that, we stood around as he told me about his encounter on the second road behind my home. It's about a mile north of here. A few other people have felt comfortable enough to share their experiences with me in the last year. I have asked them to share their experiences with you and the Sasquad, but they're unsure if they're ready. And I'm sorry, I'm not a very good writer. I jump around a lot from subject to subject, just as my mind wants to type out everything. Here is my latest, oh Jesus, what the blank is that pucker factor moment. I was driving back from Michigan one morning. On the last stretch back, I had just started south on US 250 in northern Ohio. Just on the side of the road, right there it was. Its left foot was on the road just off the white line. Its right hand was forward, just past the waist area. It was facing away from my truck, and it stood stock still as I grabbed up another gear and wound that diesel up. I can see why people say they blend into the dark and that their hair sucks up all the light. Nance, the best way to explain this to me is this. Have you ever seen something painted flat black with a cheap can of spray paint and it's oxidized? That is what the hair reminded me of. I was on the phone with my fiancé at the time, and she heard me holler out the aforementioned expletives. Then I went quiet. I could not find my voice to reply to her questions. I remember that the first thing I did see was the shadow of it as my lights went around the left and to the front side of it. When I did finally answer my fiancé, all I could say was, I don't know, I don't know, and I don't know for sure. All I could think is it was a young one, not fully grown, not filled out yet. All the very best to you, Nance, and to the Sasquad. It is late now. It's time to get some well-needed shut-eye for another long, beautiful Ohio day. Maybe I can get some more firewood cut for this coming winter. Anyway, thanks for suffering through my rambling on. Signed, Roger. Hi, my name is Carrie, and I would like to tell you a story of my Bigfoot encounter. This happened in Denton, Texas. It was in the summer of 1986. Me and my husband liked to go night fishing. At the time, we had a little one, about 8 months old, and that was the only time that I could get any fishing in, because we would take the playpen, set it up, and he would go to sleep, and that would give me a little time without having to chase him around. So we decided to go out to a little creek that jutted off the lake at Pilot Knoll Park. It was really back in the woods. There were no other people around back in there. It was a ways off the road, and we had to park the car maybe about 20 yards away from where we were going to be fishing. So we had to make several trips back and forth to get all of our gear down there. We got all of our gear down by the water, and the baby was already sleeping in the car. So I took him down, and I put him in the playpen, still asleep. I had a homemade mosquito net that I put over the playpen so mosquitoes wouldn't bite him. I sat the playpen up right next to where I was fishing. We hung the light in the tree next to the playpen so I could keep an eye on him while I was fishing. We had been there fishing for a few hours, and everything was well. There was a clearing that was about 20 feet wide next to the water where we were, and then the tree line started, and it went all the way back to a cliff that dropped down about 10 feet right behind a big tree. I had been walking over to the edge of the tree line to use the restroom all night. Anyway, we were catching a few fish, and I had been gutting them and throwing them into the cooler all night as well. As the night wore on, I started hearing something that sounded like someone throwing rocks, like small pebbles. They weren't hitting me, but they were rolling near me. I just ignored it, because I figured it was a raccoon or some small animal playing around in the trees. But what happened next was the scariest thing I have ever been through. My husband had to go back to the car to get something. I've now forgotten what it was he went to get, but he walked off, and I suddenly needed to go to the restroom. I walked over to the tree line where I had been going all night, and I squatted down. I then heard a noise by the big tree that was in front of the cliff. That caught my attention, and at first, all I could see were big eyes. It looked like maybe an owl was in the tree, so I didn't think much of it. But then, whatever it was, it started moving, and it sounded big. So I hurried up and got my britches pulled up, and I ran back to my baby, because I didn't know what that thing was. As I was watching, it climbed down off of that cliff, and it started walking right for me. It was about 6 to 7 feet tall, and it had light-colored curly hair all over it. It walked upright on 2 feet. I was so scared the hair stood up on my arms. That is the first and the last time I have ever been that scared in my life. I started yelling for my husband, but apparently he couldn't hear me. I screamed to the top of my lungs, but it just kept walking towards me. I couldn't leave. My baby was there. It didn't seem to be in any hurry, but it just kept walking slowly toward me. The water was behind me as I faced this thing, and I didn't know what to do. The closer it got, the more scared I got. When it was about 20 feet from me, I started pleading with it to please leave me alone. I said, "My baby's here," and I told it, "I would never hurt your baby." I kept pleading. Then I started praying out loud. When it got to about 10 feet from me, I was crying at this point, and I just kept pleading with it to please leave me and my baby alone. It stopped. It turned to the left, and it slowly walked away. About that time, my husband came walking up. So I don't know if my pleading, praying, begging, and crying is what made it walk away, or if it heard my husband coming and decided to leave. But as soon as my husband got back there, I told him what happened. Immediately, we packed everything up, and we got out of there as quickly as we could, and we have never went back. I am supposing that that thing was a Bigfoot. I have never seen anything like it, though. I tried to do research for years after that, but was never able to find anything even remotely resembling what I saw. A few years after that, we moved next door to an older couple that loved to go fishing. I was talking to them one day, and I thought, well, I would mention my encounter to them, see what they thought. I had learned not to talk about that encounter much, because everyone that I ever told about it before, they thought I was nuts. But when I told this elderly couple about it, the woman's eyes got big, and she wanted me to describe it to her, so I did. She said that a few years back, when they were out fishing late in the evening by Twin Bridges, they had seen it walking down the creek towards them. They were fishing from the tailgate of their truck. She said it wasn't quite dark yet, and they had noticed it when it was about 30 feet from them, and they both jumped off the tailgate and jumped into the truck and got the heck out of there as fast as they could. You are welcome to use my first name if you want to tell my story. I didn't include the name of the elderly couple out of respect for them. Signed, Carrie. Now, right after that email, Carrie sent me a couple follow-up emails, and she wanted to clarify a few things, and here's what she said. That thing looked like it had light brown curly hair. It was definitely a male. I was downhill from it, so I couldn't really tell for sure how tall it was, but I'm 5 feet 2 inches tall, and it was definitely much taller than me. My best guess, 6 to 7 feet tall, around 300 pounds. It had black or brown eyes and a face like a human man, but with hair covering all but around the eyes and the nose. It was lighter in color than I've ever heard about a Bigfoot being, but that is my best guess as to what it was. I really don't know what its intentions were, but it really didn't seem vicious or anything. And it really did act like it was at least partially understanding what I was saying, because it kept cocking its head, you know, like a dog does when they're listening to you. I did not smell anything, and it did not make any sound other than its footsteps walking towards me. Signed, Carrie. Well, Carrie, I don't know if it understood your words or not, but if nothing else, I am certain it had to have understood your tone and sensed or smelled your fear. That thing may have just been curious. It may have just been looking to get a new adoptee for the clan, you know, either you or the baby or both. Luckily, we will never know. Anyway, thank you to everyone who wrote in for tonight's encounters. And as always, if you have an encounter, you know we all want to hear it, and we're going to believe you. So put it all down in an email and send it to me at contact@buckeyebigfoot.com. I just have a couple really quick little messages. First, last week I mentioned that Easter was on the 24th. I was wrong. It's actually April 17th. Apparently, as someone pointed out, I looked at the calendar and gave the date of Easter for the Orthodox Church. All right. Well, anyway, my apologies for not looking more carefully. Also, I just want to say I've gotten a lot, and I mean tons, of great ideas for merchandise for Gatlinburg. Now, it's all down to what I can get made before the convention that A, won't cost me a fortune to have it special made, or B, it's not going to cost a fortune to sell it to you, and C, can it be made and shipped here before Gatlinburg? And you'd be surprised. Right now, I've got some things I was going to order, but they're telling me it won't be shipped till September. It's just the world today. That's how it is. And you know, prices are skyrocketing. The ceramic coffee mugs that I bought last year from Vistaprint for Gatlinburg, I went to go reorder them this year, and they've almost doubled in price. So, I will also be being pretty price sensitive because, well, who isn't these days? Who doesn't mind their pennies and dollars? I don't care how rich you are, you know? And I keep trying to keep that in mind when I get things for you guys to buy. Yeah, it might be really cool, but if it's a $60 something, ain't a lot of people going to spend $60. I know I probably wouldn't, but anyway. All right. Well, that's it for the chit-chat. As soon as I do find out what I'll be taking to Gatlinburg, I will be putting them up for everybody who is not going to Gatlinburg. And I guess I'm going to say, if you are going to Gatlinburg, let me know in the description below. I want to know some of the people I need to be looking for. All right, everybody. Thanks for hanging out with me all the way to the end. I really do appreciate it. I love my Sasquad. You guys are awesome. All right. We're going to be hanging out again real soon. And until then, always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening, everyone.